Hello, I'm Dr. Heather Lazrus. I'm a scientist at the National Center for Atmospheric Research in Boulder, Colorado. I'm also an environmental anthropologist. I'm concerned about the issues that communities face as climate changes, and I understand these issues from a cultural perspective. My research examines the role of culture in understanding and responding to climate change, including how people perceive risks, experience vulnerability, and make decisions about their future. I've spent a lot of time working with island communities where issues of climate change are very evident. Island communities are often marginalized from the powerful economic and political centers of the world. That is, they're often separated from the resources or networks needed to be prosperous. They may be particularly vulnerable to impacts of climate change because their options to deal with climate impacts are limited. Other marginalized communities may be those in other sensitive environments, such as deserts, high mountains, or Arctic lands. Or they may be populations that are underserved and have little pull with politicians and little engagement with dominant economies. Contemporary climate change is not a distant specter, but an immediate lived reality that islanders endeavor to understand and address. From resource management to migration options, island communities must find creative and culturally coherent responses to climate change. Islands are home to 1/10 of the global population, and together with their exclusive economic zones, cover 1/6 of Earth's surface. Even so, island communities are among the lowest contributors to escalating greenhouse gas emissions. Owing to global increases in greenhouse gas emissions and land use changes that contribute to climate change, the picture of island futures painted by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is deeply troubling. Over the 20th century, temperature increases in the Pacific and Caribbean oceans exceeded the global mean temperature rise. Seasonality and decadal climate oscillations are shifting, changing the variability in timing, distribution, and amount of precipitation. Hurricane intensity and frequency may be affected by warmer ocean conditions. Upward trends in sea levels lead to increased frequency of extreme sea level events when tsunamis or tropical storms move ashore. King tides, local subsidence, and land cover changes also interact with sea level rise to cause more coastal flooding of island communities. Unfortunately, sea level rise is likely to accelerate through the 21st century, reaching 50 centimeters to 1.5 meters above 1990 levels by the end of the century. Thus, these impacts contribute to cascading and cumulative disasters, for example, limiting the time and resources available to recover from one storm before another storm arrives. Human safety and food, water, and national security will be affected by all of these changes. The concerns are highest at the lowest elevations above sea level. Low-lying islands, like Tuvalu, may become uninhabitable. Tuvalu is a low-lying atoll nation in the central Pacific, about 5,000 kilometers northeast of Australia. I spent several months doing fieldwork on Tuvalu to study how people understand and cope with effects of climate change. It's an incredibly beautiful place where people have survived for thousands of years by fishing, growing taro, and cultivating coconut palms using sophisticated local knowledge and practices. Recently, people have started to notice some of the changes that I just mentioned happening in Tuvalu. Because the highest point in Tuvalu is less than 5 meters above sea level rise is a critical problem. People told me about places on the islands that had already disappeared. Because the atolls are formed from coral, they cannot store fresh water, so people are dependent on rainwater. People also told me that there were more and longer droughts now than in the past. These changes make it hard for people to stay in the islands. Even when people from Tuvalu now live in other places like Australia and New Zealand, it's important for them to know they can return home. But now people are starting to talk about migration because the islands are no longer safe. For example, the former president of Kiribati proposed a plan called Migration with Dignity. Most islanders do not think the media's term climate refugee accurately describes their situation. They think that term is disempowering. Regardless of whether migration is thought of as a form of adaptation or as a failure to adapt, the prospect of uninhabitable island homes raises important questions about citizenship and rights to sovereignty and place-based culture. How the global community responds to climate change and to the future of low-lying islands remains to be seen. Islands are often seen as isolated microcosms, but the processes and connections that extend beyond islands shape their vulnerability, as well as their resilience and capacity to adapt to climate change. While island populations are not in a position to control the fossil fuel addictions of developed nations, they're also certainly not passive victims without agency on the climate change issue. For example, a strong coalition has been formed between island governments from around the world that participate in the United Nations, called the Association of Small Island States. This coalition actively communicates the needs and priorities of island communities. At the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, Conference of the Parties in December 2015, for example, island nations led the push for reducing greenhouse gas emissions worldwide. Island communities stand to be severely affected by climate change, but they're also leaders in proclaiming how serious climate change is for our planet.